All right, today we're gonna be going over how to buy a laptop for Linux. In this video, I'm gonna tell you what to look for in a potential Linux PC and what to avoid. So now before we start this video off, I just wanna say I've installed Linux on two laptops before. This laptop over here, the Lenovo IdeaPad 32015 ABR, and my old Samsung R580. And both times, Linux ran on them flawlessly, no extra drivers to install, just go through the installation process and it worked perfectly. And another thing I want to mention before we start this video is this video is really just meant for people who are looking to buy a new laptop but haven't actually made the purchase yet. So if you already have the hardware on hand, don't even bother watching this video or doing any research aside from maybe what the boot menu key and BIOS keys are. Just run a live USB and see for yourself if it works fine. Odds are it will. If not, you can always look up how to solve any issues that you're having. You may need to include your laptop's make and model. Now, I have heard of some issues of specifically Wi-Fi cards not working. Now, most of the time, this can be resolved with just a simple kernel update, which will probably be in your regular Linux distro updates. And if you do end up needing to get a newer version than what your distro offers, then I made a video showing you how to update your Linux kernel, and I'll link that up in the card. You're going to need to have a compatible Wi-Fi card on hand or connect to your router via Ethernet to perform the update, but once it's done, it'll probably work just fine. Now, there are some proprietary Wi-Fi cards that require drivers specifically made for them by the manufacturer, and a lot of manufacturers will only provide Windows drivers or even Mac drivers, simply because it's not worth their time to support Linux. So in that case, you're going to need to find a Linux-compatible Wi-Fi driver on your own. Now, I should mention that those cases are rare, but they do happen. Like, the only example I can think of is a DWA-171 external Wi-Fi card. So, just pro tip, you might want to make sure that your Wi-Fi card is compatible with Linux before you buy it. But anyway, in this video, I'm focusing on laptops specifically. So I'm just gonna end off with, first of all, if your laptop is brand new, you may need to do a kernel update to get it working, which is why I recommend that you buy a Linux laptop that's been on the market for at least half a year, just to make sure that the Linux developers have time to catch up with that hardware, to make sure that it'll work flawlessly with Linux. And also, I do want to say, before you buy it, make sure your potential new laptop comes with standard off-the-shelf parts. Avoid any specialized hardware whose Linux support isn't quite the best yet. Like, for example, if your laptop has a fingerprint sensor, be prepared that that might not work under Linux, because Linux is just starting to support it. I think Ubuntu 20.04 was the first Ubuntu release to implement support for fingerprint sensors. And I'm gonna go over some other stuff to avoid in laptops, like Intel Optane and NVIDIA Optimus. Intel Optane, I would just avoid that since support for that on Linux isn't really there yet, since it's a proprietary technology, or I'd at least make sure that you can disable that. And with NVIDIA Optimus, which allows the laptop to use its integrated graphics when you're doing tasks that don't really need a GPU, and then use the GPU for tasks that actually do need it. Now, that's another feature whose Linux support is really not the greatest, so you may be able to get that working with proprietary drivers, but just make sure that you can at least choose which one to use, and preferably your graphics card, just to make sure that you're gonna get the graphics performance that you paid so much money for. And you may also want to research compatibility before you buy your potential new laptop, just to make sure that it works with Linux just fine. It probably will, as long as you picked a laptop that's been on the market for at least 6 months and that has pretty standard components. But this is another optional step, just to be reassured anyways. And while you're at it, you might as well look up the boot menu key and BIOS keys, just so that way when you get your new Linux box that you can change the BIOS settings and boot from your Linux flash drive no problem. And also, while I'm talking about BIOS related stuff, I'm gonna also say, make sure that you can disable Secure Boot, as that tends to not really play nicely with Linux. Now, if you're using a mainstream distro like Ubuntu, as long as you're not installing any extra kernel modules, it should be fine, but I would disable it just to make sure that applications that rely on additional kernel modules like VMware will work just fine. But now that we got that out of the way, I'm gonna go over like specific brands to avoid. The first one is Microsoft Surface tablets. Now, don't quote me on this, but from my research on them, I think they've locked it down so that way you can't be funny and load Linux on it. Though I do think that that would be a fun one one to just have. Like, to just have. Just so that way I can say to my friends, hey, I have a Microsoft Surface tablet, and I went and installed Linux on it just to be a goof. But anyway, if it is locked down in that way, which I think it is, it wouldn't really surprise me coming from Microsoft, for what I hope are obvious reasons. And the second one to avoid is Macs. Now, the thing is, especially with Apple switching to their own CPUs, that might break compatibility with Linux and also Windows and lock you on Apple's Mac OS. Now, I do remember seeing somewhere, again, don't quote me on this, that Linux might support Apple's new architecture, but I wouldn't get my hopes up for that. But anyway, the thing is, I really don't know why you'd want to shell out a couple $1,000s for a Mac just to load Linux on it. Especially since Macs, in my opinion, don't really make great Linux machines. Like, the thing is, in my opinion, the whole point of a Mac is Mac OS. Like, that's the whole experience of a Mac. So there's no sense in spending a couple $1,000s for a Linux machine just to have the Apple logo on it, when you could just spend like half of that or even a quarter of that for a regular old PC with Windows and then load Linux on it. Now, a third one to avoid, and you might be surprised at this one, is Chromebooks. Now, you might be arguing, well, the thing is, Chromebooks can make great Linux machines because Chrome OS is Linux after all, and it's not that hard to run Linux on Chromebooks, and people have had great experiences with that. It's not the point. My point is, I wouldn't go for a Chromebook, whether you're a Linux user or you're just an average Joe. It doesn't care what operating system you use, because Chromebooks tend to have very low-end hardware. Like, they're meant for more low-budget people that can't afford a PC with decent hardware. Most of them come with only 4 gigabytes of RAM, which nowadays you should have at least 8, even if you are a normal user, including if you're a Linux user. And also, a lot of them come with very low capacity. Like, the highest one I've seen is like 64 gigabyte. That's not a lot of storage space for a laptop. Even if only 5 gigabytes are taken up by the OS, it's still leaving you like a little less than 60 gigabytes for your files and applications. It's still not a lot of room. And a lot come with even less than that, like 32 or even 16, and like 27 gigs, or even just 10 gigs, like, that's not really a lot of space to work with. Don't quote me on this though, but I also believe that since they're just eMMC drives, I believe that they're soldered to the board, meaning that you can't change it. So basically that means that you're stuck with the capacity that you bought. So yeah, if you want a decent laptop, first of all, don't cheap out too much, otherwise you may end up disappointed. And second of all, don't look at a Chromebook. But other than that, if your potential new PC looks like it would be compatible with Linux, you can probably buy it and expect a flawless installation. Like, I've never had any issues installing Linux on a PC, and I find the silent majority of people don't experience any problems installing Linux on a PC, even if it is a laptop. But one bonus tip I want to mention quickly, actually I'd recommend you do this in the first place, since first of all, it can save you quite a bit of research, and second, it contributes to Linux's stats, which who knows, may end up helping Linux mass adoption happen, is just buy a laptop that comes with Linux in the first place. Like, if you're looking for something with good hardware, a couple good manufacturers are System76, who also makes Pop OS, and Dell, who offers Ubuntu pre-installed on their XPS 13 Developer Edition series. Now, at the latter, it's hidden on Dell's website, but if you just go to Dell.com and search up XPS 13 Developer Edition, you should find it no problem. Now, both these laptops are more on the expensive side, so you are gonna spend some money. But if you are on a budget and you can afford that, I would go for it. And if you do have your own distro of choice, don't worry too much about the operating system that comes with it, since you can just wipe it off anyway. And if you use something like Debian or Arch, you're probably not gonna find a laptop with either of those pre-installed, so you will need to reinstall anyway. But hey, if you can find a laptop with your distro of choice on it, well, that is the bonus of saving you time installing Linux. Though I would also look up the boot menu key and BIOS keys of those laptops, just to be sure that you can wipe off the included distro and install your distro of choice on it. But anyway, thanks for watching. If you liked this video, found it was helpful, hit the like button, share this video with your friends, subscribe to the channel, and leave a comment.